So, last time we finished with the following idea. We had definition of toric varieties. And also I gave a construction of toric variety in terms of some data called fun and so on. Yeah, from fun construction. So we had some abstract definition. So that's algebraic variety with action of a torus with no open orbit. Right, so this open. So T is torus, which means G n to some power n. Automatically, this dimension of this torus should be at least as big as dimension of variety. And if we take stabilizer of generic point, then we have the quotient torus that have exactly the same dimension. So we can assume that T is actually embedded inside X as an orbit, as the open orbit. Now, from this abstract definition, we can actually construct, given one toric variety, we can construct some other toric variety. So assume we have some subtorus T sub inside T. Say S inside T is subtorus. And then we have the quotient Q, quotient torus. Maybe this was, say, C star to the N, here C star to the maybe K, and this would be C star to the N minus K. Then, assume that we can take a quotient of X by this subtorus. If I have big group acting here, I still have the small group acting on the same space. S acts on X. So we have a map probably from X to X mod S. At least set theoretically, we can consider the set of all orbits. And now the quotient torus, it acts on the quotient variety. So Q, which is T mod S, it acts on X mod S. And you can do similar thing for if S is normal subgroup in any group. But here groups are abelian, so it's all automatic. And what are the orbits of this action? What are the orbits of Q acting on, let's call it Y. Y are the same as orbits of the bigger group T acting on X. We can just identify them. Right, so for any point, if I can move it somewhere here, then up there, I can move just all around. So this means that my quotient torus Q, it also acts on Y with an open orbit. So, so S Y is also toric. Right. Here, what was the main assumption, main non-trivial thing? So the main non-trivial thing that this guy exists as a variety. That's what we discussed. If we are given a group, then we act on variety and we want to get a quotient that might be not so obvious. Sometimes it's impossible to get exactly the quotient, the set theoretic quotient as a variety. That's what we discussed two lectures ago. Sometimes we have to glue some of the orbits. Say, if X was affine, then we have some equivalence on the set of orbits called closure equivalence. Two orbits are equivalent if they're related to each other by. So recall, if I have group acting on some space, so two orbits So O1 and O2 are closure equivalent if there exists some some sequence of orbit, let's say this way, if closure of O1 intersection with closure of O2 is non-empty, and make out of this an equivalence relation. So if one orbit is lies in the closure of the other, we say they are equivalent, and then just consider the coarsest equivalence relation when this holds. On practice, if say X is an affine variety and G is a linearly reductive group, then we prove that this equivalence relation can be just explained that this condition is enough. Right? If two orbits are closure equivalent, then their closures already intersect. For example, in the case of torus acting on affine space, that's already enough, but in general we need to consider this. And closure equivalent orbits, if we consider just the usual quotient x mod g, which is just the specter of k of invariants, then we have the natural map, affine quotient map, so x say affine. And those orbits that are closure equivalent, they go to the same point, right? So it's the fibers of this map are union of all closure equivalent orbits. Two points will go to the same point if and only if their orbits are closure equivalent and the map is surjective. The most tricky thing is about how to construct this quotient, but assume we know in some way how to construct some kind of quotient, then we have a very nice way of making toric varieties from other toric varieties. So today we will try to actually invert this construction. So assume we have some toric variety. Assume we are already given this y and s, and we want to find some other x and t that are higher dimension. Represent our y as a quotient of some space that might be simpler, but by some group. So a very simple example when we have some space with action of a torus. Just take n-dimensional vector space as x. So this is x, and as t, consider just the all diagonal matrices, right? N-dimensional torus acts on the n-dimensional vector space in quite clear fashion. Lambda 1, lambda n. So what are the orbits of this action? So orbits of this action are in one-to-one correspondence in bijection with all the possible subsets of set 1 and so on n. I so we can just give an orbit explicitly as O I is so X I non equals to 0 for I inside I and X J equals to 0 for j. Not n. I. Right, so we have 2 to the n orbits. Just if some coordinate is 0, whatever we multiply it by, it's still 0. If it is not 0, then we can multiply it by something to make it 1, for example. So you can choose representatives, points such that all their coordinates equal either to 1 or to 0. Okay, so we see that there are just finitely many orbits, and we have an open orbit that corresponds to all coordinates non-zero. So there's an action of a torus on a variety with an open orbit. And if we remove any collection of orbits, right, then we still have an action of a group with this property. Just do not remove the main orbit, and if you remove some orbit, remove this closure. Okay, so now just given this example, we can try to take this approach. Take some subtorus inside this diagonal torus, and then try to construct a quotient. Right, so GIC construction of toric so we start from group G that is some sub group inside diagonal torus. This is Gn to the n, which acts on An. The group itself is some Gm to the k. and then we want to take the quotient V mod G. Then if you can do it, as we just discussed, it will be a toric variety. Just already said theoretically, we have some set with an action of a torus such that in some set it has an open orbit, and we just want to do it as an algebraic variety. So it's already nice that this variety is affine, group is linearly reductive, so we can try to use the approach we had before and just consider the invariants. Take invariants of the thing. And sometimes it works if you have enough of invariants. So one of the examples we have considered, say, if we consider the torus that with this action, right, then the quotient was just on a fine line. So if you had x, y goes to tx to y, t minus 1 y, then invariants are k of x, y, g are k of x times y. Yeah. So we have an invariant function, and this function is good enough just to give us all the equivalence classes and so on. But also we had some more problematic example. Let's take the other way around. Let's take t 0, 0, acting on a2. Then what are invariants here? So here this xy goes to tx, ty. We see that if we take k of xy, g, then it's just a k. Right, there are no invariants because the action of Gm, action of Gm is just the gradient, and invariants are just elements that have gradient zero. And if you look for regular function there, then the only regular function with gradient zero is constant, is here. And if we look for the quotient in this way, then we, in some sense, we think that the affine quotient A2 modulo Gm, this T, T, is just a point. It is nice, it is well defined, but somehow what this says is that if you take the quotient of a plane by one-dimensional group, the quotient is a point. It doesn't look very satisfactory, and if you look for invariant rational functions, then we see that there are much more of them, right? So we have here, if we take x divided by y, so this is invariant rational function. And if you look for just field of rational functions, then this problem becomes the same. The up there and down there. So if I take k of x, y, g, here this will be just functions of z, where z is x times y, and here k of x, y, g will be functions of z, where z is x divided by y. So what this suggests, that maybe instead of looking for invariant functions, what we look here? We look for some functions that are invariant. Instead, we can look for some sections of line bundles. So maybe on varieties we don't have some. What happened for algebraic varieties? If it's a projective, we don't have any invariant functions. We may have no functions, but we always have lots of rational functions. And we always usually have some sections of bundles. So here it's very similar. We look for functions that behave well with respect to a group. So maybe we don't have invariant functions, but have semi-invariant functions. It will be fine if we have some functions f1 and so on, fn in, say, k of v, such that f1 fi divided by f1 is invariant, is invariant rational function. Then we can consider a map. Okay, let's say it x. We can write a map from x to projective space f1. And this collection of things will give me a nice point in a projective space, not in a fine space. And I can try to construct a quotient as an image of this map. There are some caveat that before, if I had some regular functions, that they give a really a map to an affine space that is everywhere defined. If I have a collection of, say, sections of some line bundle, and I consider the map to a projective space given by this collection of sections of line bundle, even if it's a regular function still, then this map does not have to be everywhere defined, right? It is not defined in the common zero loci of these functions. But this is fine, so I just want it to be defined at least in one point, then it's defined on an open subset, and then it gives me some quotient of some maybe open subset of my variety by this group. No, other way around.
Sorry?
Which map?
This map? Sorry.
This is some rational map, right? So it depends on how many functions I can find. But usually I can look for maybe some kind of invariants that. So how can I find functions that satisfy this condition? So one of the ideas is we can look for so-called semi-invariants. So if given a character Okay. From G to G. F on K of X is chi semi-invariant. That's the definition. If for any G inside G, F of GX equals to chi of G times f of x. Right, so this is a function that might be not invariant itself, but multiplied by a character, invariant up to character. Now, if I'm given two chi semi-invariants for the same function chi, then the ratio is an invariant rational function. So if f, so the it will be denoted by the following. So if R is K of X, then chi semi invariance is R chi G. So this is not an invariant, but semi invariant. So if I don't have chi here, it corresponds just to trivial character. When chi equals to one, it gives me just definition of invariant function. If chi is not one, this is semi-invariance. So semi-invariance, they form a vector space. I can add two chi semi-invariance. It's again chi semi-invariant. And if I have f and g two chi semi-invariants, then their ratio is an invariant rational function. Invariant rational. So if I, for this approach, I can just choose some chi and look for some collection of chi semi-invariants. What we can note also that if I have two semi-invariants, if I multiply them, they will also be semi-invariants for the product character. So if f belongs to R, G, chi 1, and G belongs to R, G chi 2, then f times g, it belongs to R g chi 1 times chi 2. Recall that the characters, they themselves form a group, right? If I have two such maps, I can just multiply them pointwise and it's also. Now, what this implies that if I consider sum over M belongs to Z R G chi to the M, then this is a graded ring. So, graded. Right? Because if something is invariant with respect to chi to the 2 and another to chi to the 3, their product is invariant with respect, semi-invariant with respect to chi to the 5. And now just what is the JIT quotient or proj quotient? Projective quotient. X mod G with respect to chi, where X a fine variety, G reductive group, and chi is character. So this guy is just the approach of this sum. Chi to the m, m non-negative. Right, so this is a graded ring, but it might go in both directions, right? It might happen, for example, that my that I have semi invariant of both positive and negative degree. So here I choose only some of them. For example, here, if I look for x, it will be semi-invariant for character 1, and y will be semi-invariant for character minus 1. And monomials, you can make different kinds of semi-invariants. So that's the definition. So here, to construct a quotient, we have some extra data, we choose a character, right? So, because there we want them to be. It's slightly more general than I just wrote here, because my ring doesn't have to be generated in degree 1. If it's generated in degrees 1, 2, and some other, then sometimes maybe not ratio of these functions, but ratio of their powers will be invariant, and it will give me a map not to a projective space, but to weighted projective space. Yes?
Why are characters indexed by the integers?
Huh?
Why are characters in?
No, I choose one character. And then I just take only its powers. Yeah. Because I want to have just one grading. In principle, you are right, you can take all characters and then just look for all semi-invariants, and then this ring of all semi-invariants will be graded by your lattice of characters. Okay, so maybe some obvious thing that why do we have a map from X to there? So we have our variety X, it maps to X not G. So the simplest way we can say that X is proch of some m at least zero, m r times u to the m. Yeah, so if we have just some ring, we can multiply it by a ring of polynomials of one variable and put degree one to this variable. That's a very trivial example. Approach of say r of u. Degree of u equals to 1. Then this kind of approach will give us back just our original variety that we started from. Now we have the natural embedding from here to here, because all semi-invariants, there are elements of our ring. We just embed them to r times u to the m. And this embedding, it gives us some rational map for in the other direction, right? So any map of homogeneous rings, it gives us some rational maps of their projective spectrum. So that's this map, and explicitly it's just given in coordinates like that. We choose some generators for semi-invariants, and then the point x goes to f1 of x, fn of x inside weighted projective space corresponding to the degrees of the semi-invariants. So somewhere this map is defined. Let's look where this map is defined. So it's well defined on the point of so-called semi-stable points. So x chi ss. Um, point x small inside x is called chi unstable if for any m and any f that's semi-invariant for the sky to the m, f of x is zero. What does it mean? That's exactly those points where this map is not well defined. So this map is not defined on unstable points. So x is chi semi-stable if x is not chi unstable. So all points there are either unstable or semi-stable. If it's unstable, that's exactly where the map is not defined. If they're semi-stable, it's an open subset where this map is defined. So that's open. So this is phi chi. So before we had the fine quotient, this is just the projective quotient. So with respect to chi. maybe another way how we can look at this thing. So let's look for maybe two cases. As we just discussed, if the character is trivial, chi of g equals to 1 for every g, then semi-invariants are exactly the same as invariants. And what will be this ring? This ring will be just if chi equals to 1, then r chi to the m g is the same as rg for any m. Right, so this means that sum of, maybe let's take some notation for this ring R chi. So then R chi is just the same as R G of U. Right, in all gradients we have just the same ring and that's as we discussed here. So the proj of R chi now, proj of R chi equals just to the specter of R G. Right. So if we take the trivial character, then we get back the definition of a fine quotient. So if character is trivial, this projective quotient is a fine quotient. Now if character is not trivial, if chi non equals to 1, then we can consider g chi the kernel of the character. So that's all elements of the group that go to 1 here. Right? And the r, so now r chi can be just considered it equals to invariants of R with respect to G chi. Right, so all semi-invariants, they are invariant for the kernel. That's for sure. Just clearly from the definition, right? If I take element G such that chi of G equals to zero, then it's an invariant for the kernel. And other way around, if I have something that is invariant for the kernel, if I consider this ring, then I have the action of G mod G chi here. And G mod GK is the GM. So I have action of GM here, it's the same as grading. In other words, if I have non-trivial character, I take invariance with respect to its kernel. And this is a graded ring, and that's exactly the same ring. So in this case, we can say that this proch of R chi is the same as specter of R chi. Take out copy of our original variety of X and then divide by J. So if I have projective spectrum and affine spectrum, I can compare them. And there's a natural map from affine spectrum to projective spectrum that just sends collection of affine coordinates to collection of the same projective coordinates. And it is not defined exactly in the points where that correspond to so points of spec R chi, they correspond to maximal ideals in R chi, so M. And if I have this maximal ideal, there are two cases. Either it contains all irrelevant ideals, so there are two types. So M contains sum of M more than zero, the R chi plus, which is just if you take all elements of strictly positive degree, this forms an ideal, so-called relevant ideal. Either it contains it or it does not contain it. And the ideals that do contain the thing, they give me some ideal inside the zero component. So all ideals of type 1, they form me a copy of X of my original variety that I started from, like kind of circle of my cone. If I have a gradient, it means that the spectrum will be a cone, I will have some action of GM on this. And this is the invariant points. So this corresponds to GM invariant points of spec. So I take them out, and then the group acts freely on the complement, and I take the quotient, and that's the approach. So we can break it into two parts. First, we take a fine quotient by G chi, and then we just take the quotient, remove this thing and take the quotient by GM. So the projective spectrum, as we constructed it before, it was made up of some affine pieces, right? So how we make affine pieces? We take some element of this ring and then look for the point when this element does not vanish, right? And then the complement is an affine variety and so on and so forth. So we can do the same here. Same thing here. So if F is semi-invariant R chi plus, consider the complement where f non equals to zero, then it will give us some open subset here. Right? If you consider points where some semi-invariant is non-zero, then automatically for every point here we have at least one function that is non-zero, so it's these points are automatically semi-stable, and other way around. What is this set of all semi-stable points? It's union of all df over all f. So this is union of d of f over all f semi-invariants. And again, we can think of it as union over infinite collection of open subspaces, but it's enough to choose generators, right? So if you have some generators for semi-invariants, then this point is semi-stable if at least one of the generating semi-invariants does not vanish on this point. So we make our projective quotient as a finite union of affine quotients. What I would like to say that if I take now df mod g, then it just embeds to here. Quite similarly, as we did two lectures ago, just affine quotient is embedded into this projective quotient. Essentially, we had one extra freedom of this group of homotates, GM, but this freedom is killed by this is something of positive degree, so we need to consider functions that have degree zero, so it kills this GM. Okay, so, and one more definition, the point is called stable. Maybe put it here. So X is stable if, similarly as before, this gchi of x is closed and stabilizer of x finite. So just the only thing, now we take not the whole group, but only the kernel of the character. Again, if the character is trivial, we get everything the same as we had for the affine quotient. If character is not trivial, it will be like that. And it will behave well with respect to this restriction on the open subspaces. okay, so now we got this construction, just given this data, some variety, group acting on variety and the character, we can construct such funny quotients. And the interesting thing that these quotients, they do depend on how we choose the character. Of course, if we replace character with some its positive power, then the projective quotient is the same because this ring will be essentially the same, right? It's the Veronese theorem we discussed before. But if we move it in some way along the space of all characters, then our geometry changes a little bit. And after the break, we'll discuss this moving quotients on the example of toric varieties. Okay, a few minutes ago, we defined what is the projective quotient. The data to have this projective quotient is a fine variety, reductive group, and character of our group. There's slightly more general version of this definition when you have not necessarily affine variety, still reductive group, and instead of character, you also choose some line bundle and linearization of this line bundle. We won't need it because in just what follows, we'll work with the subvariety in affine space, so all line bundles there are trivial. And just the linearization data just corresponds to the character. So I'll skip this part. For now, at least, and let's look for just how this definition works on the example that we discussed. So G is gm to the k, and X is affine space A some n plus k. Then what is the character Kai belongs to home GGM? So this is z to the k. That's some lattice now, right? Do not confuse this lattice with the lattice of characters of our torus, because it's different just dimension. Even. Right? If I take the quotient, so the character essentially is a k numbers, right? If you choose some basis here, k integers, and how to give the action of this guy here? This is matrix k times n minus k, right? So g acting on x is given by k times n plus k integer matrix. It is just essentially the map from this gm to the k to the, say, diagonal torus here. If I have this action, then in some basis it's diagonal, and I have the whole diagonal group, and I have an embedding of my subgroup inside this diagonal group that's given just. So maybe if I write it explicitly, let's put it here. A11, AK1, and so on, A1N, AKN. Let's say N is N plus K. That's K times M matrix. And this guy we can also draw it maybe as some B1 and so on, BK. So this matrix as itself we can consider as N different characters, right? If you have the eigenbasis, then my group acts on every one-dimensional space by character. So altogether I have n plus one characters, but one of them is distinguished. One that corresponds to my stability condition, so-called, okay, and the other just corresponds to the action. This action. Okay, so what are the unstable points for this data? But I claim that this data already gives me, just I can start from this definition and look for unstable points.
Can you repeat
what
is
this
B vector again?
Sorry?
What is
this
B vector again?
B?
Yeah.
B is chi.
Okay.
Just maybe one easier notice that automatically, since we have this construction, just if we apply this machinery to this setup, then we get a toric variety. We naturally have the torus acting on this quotient, just as we discussed from the beginning, the quotient torus. Or we can just say that original big diagonal torus, it acts on the quotient, but this action will have a kernel given by G. So the quotient torus, it will act as the open orbit. Maybe let's consider some examples so it will be more clear what this means. So how to construct, say, projective space? What is the data we need for the projective space? This, in principle, we already know, right? So we want to say, example, p, say, n minus 1. We start from g equals to gm, and the character chi and the action action is given by just one, and so character chi is correspond to some number, say k. So, what are the possibilities? If k equals to zero, then just look for invariants, right? You look for invariants of the section, so c of z1, zn, gm, and that's just c. Yeah? So there are no invariants because that's just we discussed before, that's positively graded. So my ring will be c of u, and proch of c of u is just a point. Now, assume k is more than zero. For example, k equals to one. As we discussed, if you take some multiple, it will give me the same answer, so it doesn't really matter. Then, what is g chi in this example? Then g chi is just a trivial group, right? What is the character? Just the trivial. So, as a ring, the invariance with respect to g chi is just the original ring, but now it's graded, and I take its proch, right? So. This gives me the proch of C of Z1, Zn, which is projective space, Pm minus 1. Now, if k is less than, say, 0, for example, k equals to minus 1, again, gk is 1, but there are no semi-invariants of negative degree. Right? Just if you look for all semi-invariants, then they all concentrated only for k non-negative. If I look for negative degree, there's nothing, then we get again the point. So, point. No, it's not even... Sorry, it's not even the point because it's just the empty space. We get the proch of just C, so it's, there's nothing. Or in the other setup, we take specter of C, it's a point, then we throw away a point, and then we take the quotient by gm, so it's an empty set. So we see that when our k in some way moves from plus infinity to minus infinity, we have some projective space that collapses to a point and then disappears. Do you already had the moment maps? No? On Alexeyev's course. Probably something like that happened. Yeah. It's very similar in the sense. So the choice of chi, it corresponds to the choice of the fiber of a moment map. Yeah. Over there. Okay, now let's look for something maybe more funny. If you start just with one, with group gm, there's not so many choices. We can replace maybe this weights by some other weights. Let's put w1 and so on, wm. So if all wi are strictly positive, then we essentially get the same, but instead of projective space, we get weighted projective space. So p w1 w. Right, at projective space that collapses to a point. If sum of them equals to zero, then this a little bit trivial. It just means that in our quotient, the group does not act on some coordinate, so we'll have just a fine space as one of the factors. So our projective quotient will be product of affine space and something else. Can without loss of generality, wi non equals to zero. If all of them are negative, it's the same, we just replace the important characters for us will be negative, for minus infinity we'll have some space and then it will collapse over there. And finally, it can happen that both positive and negative, so now assume some wi more than zero and some wj is less than zero. This will imply that if we look for the semi-invariants, then we will have semi-invariants of all degrees, positive and negative. let's look for maybe some simple example. Say n equals to p plus q, w1 equals and so on, wp is plus 1, and w p plus 1 and so on w p plus q is minus 1. And let's denote these coordinates by x1 xp, and here coordinates here is y1 yq. Maybe it was just to notice the fact that when we have something given by this construction, then our quotient will have some kind of homogeneous coordinates. What used to be affine coordinates here, we can consider them as homogeneous coordinates on the quotient. In what sense? That if we take some of their combinations, they will be rational functions. And what kind of combinations it corresponds to? Just it has to be trivial character with respect to G. Right? And the coordinates themselves, they become sections of some line bundles on the quotient. And it's actually a fact about toric variety. So this kind of construction probably was invented by Cox, or at least developed by Cox. And together with this construction, he defined a thing called the Cox ring. So Cox ring. Somehow universal ring of homogeneous coordinates. So that's universal homogeneous coordinates, which is defined Cox of Z is sum over all L inside peak Z, global sections Z L. If I have some global section of some line bundle and global section of some other line bundle, then their tensor product is global section of a product of these bundles. For this, to make this consistent, I need to choose the isomorphisms between products of my bundles and the bundle. But if I choose things like that, then I get this ring. So now the fact that variety is toric, if and only if it's Cox ring, is just ring of polynomials. It's not really a coincidence that we have these quotients here. Z toric, if and only if Cox of Z is ring of polynomials, C of some Z1. Okay, so if I'm given weights like this, what are the possible semi invariants? So invariants are, so W, so Xi are semi-invariants of degree 1, right? So Yj, semi-invariants of degree minus 1. And all other semi-invariants, just any monomial is, of course, semi-invariant of degree, that's some of those. So we see that have both of them, and now the invariants of the thing, the is generated by all the possible products xi times yj. Let's denote it by zij. J. Yeah, by the way, what was the unstable unstable points in this example? So if you start from k equals to zero, then we see that semi semi-invariant searching is just constants, so everything, all points here were semi-stable, right? So just the whole space was constructed to a point. We don't have to take out anything. If you take this example, then the generators are all Z1, Zn, so their common zero locus is just the origin, Z1 equals and so on to Zn equals to zero. So the point zero was unstable and we have to take it out. Our map was not well defined there. Our map was just sending collection of affine coordinates to the same collection of projective coordinates. And it was not defined exactly in one point. And if we look here, then all points are unstable. So that's why we have the empty set, because we just don't have any characters of positive degree. We don't have any semi-invariants of positive degree for this degree. So now what does it mean that if we take k equals to zero, then our quotient a p plus q modulo say zero by gm, it will be just a cone over Segre variety, right? So it will be affine variety with these generators and relations are, it's C of, it's a spec of C of Zij modulo rank of this matrix equals to 1, not bounded by 1. Right, so we have quadratic equations that look like Zij, Zkl equals to Zil, Zkj. So it's some affine cone over product of two projective spaces, P minus 1 times Q P minus 1 over now, if k equals to 1, then we already have some semi-invariants of positive degree, right? So, and in fact, so R chi to the 1 is generated by just this thing, R0 and X1 and so on, XP inside R1. Right, so it's generated by R0 that's given by the Zij and these guys. Just if I have any semi-invariant of positive degree, I can express it as a polynomial of x and these things. But these generators, they are of course related to each other, right? So and what are the relations? Relations are the following, that If I extend this matrix, then still it has rank 1. Right? So because this Zij was some product, so x1 and so on, xp, z1, 1, z1p, zq1, zqp, rank of this matrix, now it's equals to 1. So the difference here, it was not more than 1, and here it has to be equal to 1, because if all of these things vanish, it will be unstable point, right? Now, unstable points, unstable points are x1 equals to xp equals to 0. So my quotient is just if you think a little bit of what this means, that now the quotient is a bundle over projective space with fiber. So the quotient A P plus Q, we take out this x1 equals to xp equals to 0 mod gm is a bundle over P minus 1 with fiber. A vector space. So it's just vector bundle over this thing. It has the same dimension as this guy. So it's P plus Q minus 1. So it's a vector bundle of rank Q. And similarly, if I take K equals to minus 1, then the unstable points will be given by equality of Y1 equals and so on to YQ to 0. And the quotient will be vector bundle over pq minus 1 of rank p. Yeah. And just will be given by similar relations, but here I need, instead of x, I put here y. Yeah.
So we have got something non-proper because there are infinitely many generators in degree 1.
Hmm?
Oh. So, vector bundle over projective space is not compact.
Not compact.
But though we have to take some approach of something, and approach of something seems to be compact.
It's compact if R0 is a field, and in our case R0 is a big ring, right? R0 is just still generated by the Zij. So it's always compact over specter of I0.
Okay, so and all this are K.
So here, what does it mean? That if we can consider the forgetting map, we can forget X, just if we have collection of X and Z, forget X. Then the fibers, they are projective spaces. Most of them are just empty or points or just a projective space. Yeah, so it's projective over this thing. And actually the forgetting of X, it gives us a map from this quotient to this quotient. So we have A P plus Q mod minus by GM. maps to A P plus Q mod 0 by GM, and this maps by A P plus Q mod plus by jump. It will be always like that if you could just have an action of a multiplicative group. Then essentially you have three types of quotient: positive, negative, and zero, just corresponding to the choice of the character, whether it's positive, negative, or zero. And if you look for the zero, then it's essentially will be this affine variety, right? It will be just the specter of the invariants. It will be written in slightly different way. Just we take invariants, then take multiply them polynomials of one degree and take approach, but still it's the specter of the invariants. If you take positive or negative, it will be non-trivial, but still it is always have a map to back to the specter of R0, to the specter of the invariants. So you have this map and you have this map. In our example, this was some vector bundle over projective space, that was also vector bundle over projective space, and this map, they contract this projective space to a point. This guy was some cone over product of two projective spaces. So this map is an isomorphism everywhere outside of the zero section. So this maps, these are contraction, contract zero section to point zero. And here also contract zero section to point zero. So what does it mean? If I take here an open set, everything except for zero, then it's isomorphic to some open set here, the complement to the zero section. And also it's isomorphic to an open set here, the complement to the zero section. So these two things, they are birational to each other. They have open dense subset that is isomorphic. But this map, it never can be extended to a regular map, neither in this direction, neither in this direction, if both P and Q are P more than one and Q more than one. So this map is called a flip. Flip. So actually the terminology is the following. So if P equals to Q, then it's a flop. If P more than Q, then maybe it's a flip. And if P is less than Q, it's inverse flip. And that's a very interesting transformation that happens in higher dimensional geometry, starting from dimension 3. In many pieces, so you see that you have something that has co-dimension more than it's defined outside of the closed subsets that has co-dimension more than one. They are not divisors. For example, if P equals to Q equals to two, then all my varieties here, they are three-dimensional, right? So this is just the quadric given just by equation AB equals to CD. This is total space of O of 1 plus O of 1 over P1, and this is another total space of O of 1 plus O of 1 over P1, and this map is called Atia flop. Atia flop. If you have seen the exercises number 5, I think, not the last one, but the previous, it's in the end of those exercises when this example is discussed in some detail. And for those two maps, you can consider their common resolution. So you, if you take total space over P, P minus 1 times P, Q minus 1 of O of minus 1 minus 1, then it maps to here and to here. So this is total space over P1 of O of minus 1 times C2. In the exercise sheet, it's written in more invariant way that this you can identify actually the spaces. If this was, if Cn was u plus v, then one of those guys will be total space over P of u of o minus 1 times v, and another will be total space over P of v of o minus 1 times u, and this is total space over P of u times P of v of o of minus 1 minus 1. And this is just the cone over P of u times P of v. Okay, and maybe one more comment, just how to. So what do we see? That we have one geometry where k is positive, slightly different geometry when k is negative, and when k goes to zero, we have some contraction. We have some zero section contracting to a point here and zero section contracting to a point here. When you try to do the same in terms of symplectic geometry, what's the relation actually? So if you introduce on Cn relation to symplectic geometry, if on your Cn you introduce the standard metric Euclidean or Hermitian metric, Hermitian sum mod zi square, and the standard symplectic form omega sum dzi dzi bar up to sum 2 pi, whatever. Omega is constant times this. Then action of diagonal torus C star to the n, it acts on Cn. So inside diagonal torus, I can decompose always complex number to those that have absolute value 1, that's u1 times just positive. So here I have u1 to the n. Now, the point is that this group acts here by Hamiltonian transformations. So if I restrict to the subgroup, this is the Hamiltonian action. Hamiltonian. With respect to just this standard symplectic form. If I take any subgroup, it's still a Hamiltonian action. And now, what I can do, so I take some subgroup here G, and here I have some u1 to the, so G is C star to the k, this is u1 to the k. So I have Hamiltonian action of this group here, and I can just take the symplectic quotient using this Hamiltonian action. So if I do the symplectic quotient, then I have to do two pieces. First, I take the moment map. It goes in two parts. Moment map. From Cn to Rk. Right? And just if I look for the whole group, who knows what's the moment map?
Just some of those things.
Yeah, essentially zi goes to mod of zi. Yeah.
It's a corner of RK.
It's what?
A corner of like
an
intersection of half.
Yeah, I mean in coordinates, like how to write it.
All coordinates are needed. If you take the moment minus one half,
essentially it's z goes to mod z square. So z1 zn goes to z1 square zn.
Okay, so now the coordinates are positive. Huh? Or the coordinates are positive.
You mean the image of it?
Yeah.
But just the map is like this, right? So now if I have some subtorus, it corresponds to some just composition of this map with some projection. Yeah, so, and then this goes to some linear combinations, linear functions of mod zi square. Yeah. So if I take the fiber of the moment map, it will be given by some equations like sum of ai mod zi square equals to zero, where this ai corresponds to this matrix that we erased. We had some k times n minus k matrix, so that this gives, I can think of it, k times n matrix as k linear equations on this. So this aij will be what's the combinations. So first I take the fibers of the moment map, and then on the fibers of the moment map, I have the group. My group is still acting there, and I take the quotient. Here, so when I take the fibers of the moment map, I restrict to something of real codimension k. And then when I do this quotient, it's again, the dimension, real dimension decreases again by k. Here instead it's just quotient by k dimensional torus, and our complex dimension reduces by k, and real dimension reduces by 2k. So this torus, we can kind of decompose it into u1 to the k times r plus to the k. And essentially taking these fibers of the moment map is like taking something that's transversal to this r plus to the k. We already take a quotient by real positive, and then we just quotient by this thing. Now, for example, if you start from this example where my action was 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, so here the moment map was just z1 squared plus and so on plus zn squared. Mu of z. And this is a Morse function on Cn, right? Just in terms of coordinate, what are the levels of this function? If I look for mu of z equals to some number k, if k is big, then levels is a sphere. And then I take the quotient of the sphere by circle and I get a projective space. And then when k decreases, this projective space, just what changes, it's always the projective space, but with a slightly different symplectic form, the symplectic volume. It disappears, and when k goes to zero, my sphere becomes a point here, right? So sphere contracts to a point, and the quotient is a point. Then k is negative, and this is just the empty space. So, and you can see that it's very just similar to what happens here. Just here we take the quotient simultaneously, and we have to deal with removing some unstable things, and here they are removed in a sense automatically. And if you do this example, then the moment map will be here mu of z is mod x1 squared plus and so on plus mod xp squared minus mod y1 squared minus and so on minus mod yq squared. So here you see that topology is slightly different. Now this form is not positive-negative, so we always have some fibers, and still there's the unique critical value for this function, it's zero. Right? We have a unique critical point, but it has index pq instead of... So we have some change of topology happening over there, and that's what we see on this picture. Or if p is equals to q, then topology is the same, but still the transformation is non-trivial. And just a few comments about relation of this thing and the fun, right? So in both cases, we had some discrete and linear data, and we can actually make some correspondence between those two. The correspondence is a little bit one way. So if you are given given JIT data, JIT data, which is action matrix K, which is K times N and character chi, which is k times 1, you can produce a fun. If you go other way around, of course, you cannot reconstruct the character because this the thing how it depends on the character. So far, we've seen only one-dimensional example when the group is one-dimensional. But we can go for higher dimension, then the space of all possible characters, it will decompose into various cones where the quotient does not change. So what happens that usually when I move my character a little bit inside, say, the real space, the quotient remains the same unless I cross some bad direction, wall. And on two sides of the wall, something like this happens. Here just the wall was zero, but it can happen on higher dimension that my space of characters of stability conditions or characters breaks into some chambers, and for each chamber, for every cone, it corresponds to its own geometry. The variety is the same, but it gives me slightly different line bundles of these varieties. You see here by this construction, I get something that is my construction gives me approach, so it gives me slightly more. It also gives some bundle on my space. So choice of character just corresponds to different choices of the bundles.
I just don't understand your remark about the chambers, because we are in the complex case, right? So if you take out some zero hyperplane, it would still be connected, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So
what was the question?
No, I didn't understand the link with chamber and
this character, yeah. No, this is space of characters. It's inside RK, which is R times Z to the K. Z to the K is homomorphisms from G to Gn. And we have to choose, of course, the integer points here, right? And what I say that if we want to know what kind of variety do we get, actually, it depends on, so the space of all characters, it decomposes into some chambers. It's not the picture of the fun of a toric variety. It lives again in different dimension. For example, here we considered case k equals to 1, and it was like this, positive, negative, or 0. And we had different behavior, whether it's positive, negative, or 0. And in higher dimension, it will break into more complicated thing. Because you cannot say what is positive inside two-dimensional space. It can be positivity is replaced by some cones. So given this thing, we can get a fun. How do we get a fun? So for fun, we need two pieces of data. So what is fun essentially? It's a collection of vectors in z to the n, where n is the dimension of our variety. Collection of n vectors in z to the n, where n is some other number. Plus some combinatorial structure, the simplicial complex on a sphere, plus simplicial complex on s n minus 1, which is r, that's n, in n r factor n r minus 0 modulo r plus. If you take this n-dimensional space, we can think of a unit sphere inside this n-dimensional space, but it's better to think of the sphere not as embedded, but as a quotient. All possible rays inside n-dimensional space, it's an n minus one dimensional sphere. So if I have some collection of cones in a space, then the image of the cone on a sphere, it will be some either simplex, if it's simplicial cone, or maybe simplicial or polyhedral complex there. Yeah. And so how to get, so this data, collection of vectors, is linear algebraic, and this data is just combinatorial, right? I just need to take a sphere and take some subdivision. Maybe of the either whole sphere or part of the sphere. If my fun is complete, then it's just some polyhedral subdivision of the whole sphere. If it's not complete, it's polyhedral subdivision of sphere with some holes. So and some identification also between these vectors and the vertices of the subdivision, plus identification of n vertices of a complex with n vectors. So how do we do it? This, what is the action matrix, right? So A, it belongs to homomorphisms from Gm to the K to the M, right? And so we have map from Gm to the K goes to Gm to the N, and then the image is the Gm to the n minus k, that's the quotient torus that will act on our variety, right? That's T. Now, m was characters, in terms of fun, m was homomorphisms from T to Gm, right? And n was a dual lattice. N was homomorphisms from m to z, which is the same as homomorphisms from Gm to T. Right, it corresponds to one parameter subgroups. Now, if you take the essentially just if this embeddings now, this matrix is matrix of the characters. When we had apply homomorphism from these guys to Gm, right? So I have z to the n that goes to the z to the k by a, and here I have m. And now if I take the dual again, which just corresponds more or less to transposing my matrix A, A transposed, z to the k goes to z to the n goes to m. And so how do I construct n? I take essentially the transposed matrix and take the quotient. Here I want to have the condition that the image here is the saturated sublattice. And then I just take the primitive vectors are images of. So n, just n is constructed as this quotient, right? And the image of basic vectors, they correspond to primitive vectors pi. So this is how I construct the linear data. So linear data is very simple linear algebra. Just transpose the matrix and take the image, right? So transpose the matrix, take the kernel, and take the image. This transformation is called Gale transform, as far as I know. Gale transform. But it's basically just transposing your matrix and doing this thing. And the combinatorial data, so this thing, it does not depend on the choice of chi. This is always the same for all chi. So all your toric varieties obtained by different chi, they will have the same collection of primitive vectors. So they will have the same collection of vertices, but what will change is the collection of the simplices that I draw. This depends on chi, and in the following way that we already actually explained in the very beginning. So note that if x inside Cn is chi unstable, then whole C star to the n times x is also chi unstable. Whole orbit of x with respect to big torus. On Cn I had 2 to the n orbits that corresponds to some coordinates equals to 0 or non equals to 0. Then is chi unstable. So what does it mean? That if I want to throw away unstable points for any chi, it means I throw away some collection of basic orbits of the big torus. And then the remaining, what I have not thrown away, the semi-stable points, they form me orbits for the big torus, and their images will form me the orbits of the will form the orbits of the quotient torus up to something. So now just this unstable loci, they are parameterized by some collection of subsets, right? So unstable orbits, they give me collection of subsets I1 and so on IL inside 1 and so on N. And just this collection of subsets, it corresponds to the collection, to your simplicial decomposition. Just I might leave as an exercise to write down this explicitly. So just the combinatorial part of the fun, what simplices do you take? It corresponds exactly to what points become unstable here. And there are only finitely many choices of this thing. So you see that your space of all characters, it breaks into finitely many pieces on depending how this works. Not all of them are realizable, not necessarily. So it's some interplay between some linear algebra and combinatorics. The linear algebra is how you embed your torus. It will give you different geometry. And combinatorics is how it acts. Okay. We have not distributed the exercises for today, but they are very simple, just what you already know about toric varieties. Now you can rephrase in this new language, realize them as JIT quotients, and see how this works.